I hear feel the darkness breaking. I met the devil shaking. Somebody celebrate. I see an empty grave. I was sure by now that you would have reached down and wiped Todd's tears away, stepped in to save the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still raining. And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I raise my hands and praise the kind who cares and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my head. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, and though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. I remember when I stumbled in the rain. You heard my cry and raised me up again. But my strength is almost gone. How can I carry on if I can't find you? And as the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as the mercy falls, I raise my hands and praise the God who cares. It takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. For you are who you are, no matter where I am. Every tear I cry, you hold in your hand. You never left my side, though my heart is torn. I will praise you in this storm. Oh.
I lift my eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I lift my eyes unto the hills.
Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And I'll praise you in this storm. I'll lift my head. You are who you are, no matter where I am. And every tear I cry, you hold in your head. You never left my side, though my heart is torn, I will praise you in this storm. have reached down and wiped our tears away. You may be seated.
And now baptizing my brother.
In the name of your profession of faith, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Let me try that again. There we go. Well, amen, right? Amen. Yeah, glory to God. Y'all were busy while I was gone last week. I knew that was happening. I hated that I was going to miss it, but I knew that it would happen anyway. You know, whenever the guy in the book of Acts, the Ethiopian eunuch, whenever he come to Christ, he immediately said, "What doth hinder me to be baptized?" And he said, "If you believe." And he said, "I believe." And they went down immediately and baptized him. It's always good. You want me to tell you one way you can know somebody probably really come to know Christ as their Savior? That is, they're willing to follow him in believer's baptism. I mean, just obedience. You don't have to pray about it. It's one of those things. So good to be back. Everybody glad to be here this morning? Wow. Welcome to Riverwoods Church. Thank you for giving us a little break to be gone last week. Everybody that filled in, Ethan, the band without Lakin being here and all of that, we appreciate you so much. Make it possible. There was no fear on my end that everything was going to be handled well. Carolyn wasn't here. Lakin wasn't here. I wasn't here. And guess what? We're all still alive this Sunday. Amen. Everything made it, passed the test. If you're new to Riverwoods Church, thank you for being here. I'm going to ask you to do something we ask our regular attenders to do each week, and that's fill out what we call our connection card. There'll be one laying in a seat near you, or if you have the YouVersion app, you can go to More and Events and type in Riverwoods Church. It'll probably pull it up that it's there, first thing you'll see, and click that, and there's a link in there for you to fill out this. Also, on the email that goes out Thursday, Friday, every week, this is there. If you want to go ahead and open that and fill that out, you can. If you want to open that and print out the outline, you can. One of the main reasons that we use this is to get information, but also connect with people, but to get prayer requests. So if you would, in that comments and prayer section, you can share that. I'm going to need you, if you're coming to Vision Night, to either do it on this card or electronically one today, and here's why. We need to make sure that we've got enough hamburgers for everybody to eat. I'm not near as concerned that you have one to eat as I am concerned we have enough for me to eat one, all right? And I usually go later at those things, and so we need to know if you've got you and significant other spouse coming and three kids coming. We need to know that who's coming. That's Vision Night next Sunday night at 5:30. We will eat. We're not doing anything fancy this year. Hamburgers and hot dogs is what we're doing. We're preparing those here, trying to do everything kind of in-house this year. That way, with COVID going on, we have a little bit more oversight of what's happening with the food and that. And so we'll be buying chips. If we have dessert, it'll be store-bought desserts this year. So you don't have to bring anything but yourself. But we need to know if you're coming. If you're going to eat. I said this last year, and it wound up being long anyway. Vision Night, we're doing it a little bit late, doing it a different time, but we are going to do it, and we are excited about it, so we hope that you plan on being here. But meal will start at 5:30. We'll need some help immediately after the services. Next Sunday, we will tear down these chairs and set tables up. And put them around that, so if you would plan on helping us after the 10:30 service next Sunday. Also, we're getting ready to do an outreach event on Glow Off Maine, and it's really on Halloween night. And there are all kind of ways that you can participate in that and help in that. There is a table out in the vestibule where you can sign up. You can provide stuff. You can say, I'm going to help. We need traffic control. We need people to help. We're going to block our drive-thrus off where when people come in, it's completely dark in there and everything will be glow-in-the-dark stuff with black lights and that. And so just doing a little something for our community because so much has been shut down because of COVID. We will have a meeting next Sunday night right after the vision night. And so plan on being there if you're going to volunteer and help with this event. This will be really the first outreach event since we've done since like February or March of this year. And so it's one of our first ones. And so we hope that you'll participate with us. Also in your seat is what we call our offering envelope. You can do it that way or you can give online. There's a link on that YouVersion app that'll take you to giving. Also tells you in here how to text to give. How to give online. You can use this to give by way of credit card, check, or cash. So we want to make it as easy as we can for you to give. And unfortunately, it takes money. God knew that it took money to operate the church. That's why he taught us to give. By the way, he said much more about giving than he did about heaven or hell. Did you know that? He did. He knew the hardest thing wasn't to get us out of hell. It was to get the money out of us after he got us out of hell. So that's why he said more about giving. We have some great people that's faithful to give. It's kind of their spiritual gift and their calling. And thank God for them. Because of that, we're able to survive and make it. Just ask yourself this question. If everybody gave like me, how long would Riverwoods be here? If everybody gave like me, how long would Riverwoods be here? So I encourage you to give and pray for God. God loves generous people. Amen? He just blesses generous people. He does. I'm sure there's some other announcements that I'm supposed to tell or talk about, but I'm glad to be back, just wanting to sing, wanting to worship the Lord. Got a message that I want to share and preach to you today. You were given an outline, I believe, when you came in today. We haven't been handing anything out, but I'm going to do some things unique in the message today. Did anybody not get an outline? You didn't. You were probably busy up here with me, helping me. So, good. You're going to get to use your drawing skills at some time in the message today. If you don't have one, Brett here will be glad to give you one. He's bringing it to you. All right. Glad that you're here. Let's stand. And I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing and worship our Lord through song and then through his word and message and prayer and all of that today. Father, we love you. Thank you for the privilege to be here and worship you. God, I thank you for faithful people at Riverwoods Church, that they can just be counted on. They're here in their spot, serve. And God, help us to be more like Jesus, God. Thank you for these people that even in the middle of a pandemic may be risking their health to be able to get the gospel to other people. And God, so we thank you for them. Thank you for those that's watching online and other ways. And God, we just pray that you would move in the service today. God, the music's been great, and we praise you for that. Continue to use it in the rest of this service. Thank you for the privilege to know you, to love you, to serve you, and to tell others about you. God, if there's somebody here today that don't know you, Christ as their Savior, I pray today that they would come to know him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's always been a mystery. All my life I've been told I belong at the end of the line with all the other non-whites, with all the never getting rights. But it
Turns out they're the ones you were looking for all this time. Cause I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living brought a rock to a soul fire. Many change the world. Everybody's got a purpose.
When I hear that devil start talking to me,
who do you think you are? Say I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Nobody but Jesus.
So let me go down, down, down.
Go down in history.
And let the blood, dark, faithful member of the family.
That's all I ever want to be.
If they all forget my name, well, that's fine with me. For the world to see,
nobody but Jesus. Yeah, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody all about somebody who saved my soul. Ever since you rescued me, you gave my heart a song to sing. I'm living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world to see, nobody but Jesus. Living for the world. Nobody but Jesus.
Symphony in my ear, like holy water on my
Man, that sounded good today, wasn't it?
My husband rocked today.
Man, it was good. Wow, welcome. My name's Darren. If you're new around here, if you don't know this, every year about this time of year, sometime in October or the beginning or toward the end, we make our annual duck hunting trip. We went to North Dakota 4 years ago, and then the last 3 years we've gone to Canada. And we wanted to go to Canada again this year, but however, COVID wouldn't allow us to go into Canada. The main guy we hunt on there, the family, the people, they own 250,000 acres in Canada, and we get to hunt on any bit of it that we want to. They're a religious sect of people, Hutterites or Hutterians, and we wanted to call him. I told him he called me. While we was loading stuff in the trailer, knew we wasn't going to get to come. They just finished harvesting. I said, yeah, we thought about asking you, would you just tell us you needed us to come help you harvest? We could be essential workers to help you get your crop in. I believe he would have done it, but it had been too much red tape. And so we went back to North Dakota this year. We had a great trip. Everybody thinks it's all fun. It's a lot of work, to be quite honest with you. It's a whole lot of work, long time to drive. But it's worth it to us. Get up early and stay late. Don't get enough sleep. Do a lot of work. There's a lot of preparation. Lakin does more of it than any of us for us to be able to go. And I would consider myself more of a sportsman, outdoorsman, than what you'd call an athletic sports person. I ran track. I played football for a little bit. In junior high and high school, I wasn't really that great. I was pretty good at in track, but not football. I spent most of my time, you know, trying not to get splinters, and that did a lot of what I would call bench time. It got me ready to set in a duck blind and in layout blinds, lay around and wait. But something that I have noticed. Athletes or outdoorsmen, if you're good at it, you know, let me tell you what you have to do. You have to prepare. You have to train. You have to be equipped. The best athletes that you know, they've done a lot of training. In fact, they are still training, even though the professionals, they still work and train and prepare and get equipped. So when it comes to sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ, here's what I really believe is that most people want to share their faith. Most people want to talk to others about knowing Christ as their Savior. But however, they don't do it. And it isn't because that they don't want to. I used to think they're just all hellions and rebellious, probably not even saved because they don't want to share the gospel with others. But I've come to understand that that's not true. Some of us have the spiritual gift of evangelism. Some of my professors didn't want to believe there's a gift of evangelism, and the reason being, they said other people will say, well, I don't have the gift of evangelism, and they think they don't have to share the gospel. And the truth is, the Word of God tells all of us to share the gospel. Every one of us is to share our faith with other people. It's just something that God teaches us to do. Some people have the gift of evangelism. They can draw the net more effectively than other people can. I happen to have that gift. There's some other people here that happen to have that gift. And so it doesn't mean that we're better, we're more spiritual, or anything of that nature. It just means God gifted us uniquely and differently. But here's what I found out, is that all of that came through a right relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. It came through what I would call being infilled with the Holy Spirit of God, because before that, I wasn't bold in my witness. In fact, I was an introvert. I was a standoffish type person. You wouldn't believe that being around me now that I was that way. But after God called me to preach and after being filled with the Holy Spirit of God, He changed me. He changed my life. And here's something that I want you to know, a real evidence of being full of the Holy Spirit of God can be some of these supernatural things that people talk about. But I can tell you one sure evidence of being full of the Spirit of God and the Word of God, and that is that you are a witness of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, and they received power after the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they were witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world. I don't care how many unknown languages you speak in, how much healing you say that you have in your hand, how much you bark like a dog, roll around on the floor like a lion. If you won't walk across the street and tell somebody about Jesus, you don't have the Holy Spirit the Bible's talking about. Because what? It says that that's what you'll be. They did. They shared the gospel. And listen, that's where part of the confidence, the boldness comes from. You say, Brother Darren, how can I be filled with the Spirit? Just like you were saved. You got to do it by faith. Believe God, said that He would, ask Him to do it. Fill me, empty of myself, fill me of you. And then what? God can use you. And so I do believe in that. I don't have the gift of speaking in tongues. Some people have the gift of speaking in tongues. I'm not one of those that believes everybody that's full of the Holy Spirit will absolutely do that. It didn't happen in the Bible. And so what do we judge everything? By the Bible, not by our experience. And so we look in the Word of God. But one thing that did happen, they were witnesses. They shared the gospel of Jesus Christ. Most people really want to share their faith. Most people really want to talk to others about Jesus. But why don't they? They're a little bit afraid. They're a little bit scared. They feel uncomfortable to do it. And I want you to know that I used to think that wasn't natural, but that is natural. It's rooted in they are not prepared. In fact, for some of you to think about sharing your faith with somebody else, it would just freak you out. Why? Because you're not prepared. You're not ready. You haven't been equipped. You haven't been trained. So we're going to help a little with that today. The Great Commission is what we're talking about in this series of Go. And what we are talking about is the final words of Jesus before He left here. And He told them to go. In fact, if you were to sum up the Great Commission with one word, it'd be this word, go. And that's what He wants to do. In fact, if you're going to look at somebody, what they really say is important, you would look at their last words, right? And the last words of Jesus is He's telling us to go. The Great Commission. Read it along with me here. Jesus said this. You were given an outline, so you can do that today. I've been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Let me try this one more time. Read this along with me out loud. All right, let's go. Are you ready? I have given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I'm with you always, even until the end of the age. Wow. Some of that was hard for you because you memorized it in the King James, and so you struggle with that. But that's the heart of that, is to go. Go make disciples, and then what? Teach them to follow His commands, and them to go make disciples. It's really one of these perpetual things that's supposed to happen. That's what God wants us to do. So I'm going to give you three steps to prepare to go. Three steps to prepare to go. First of all, and I'm going to hit these pretty quick, be available for God to use me. Be available for God to use me. You say, Brother Aaron, what's that mean? Open to anything that God asks you to do. We kind of say it a little different around Riverwoods. We say it this way, put your what? Yes on the table. Put your yes on the table. Let me ask you something. Is your yes on the table when it comes to God? God wants to use you. By the way, be available. Something you might want to write down. God's more interested in availability than He is ability. God's more interested in availability than he is ability. In fact, when you study the Bible, God didn't always choose the best, the smartest, the sharpest, the most educated. He used the ones that were willing. When you look at the 12 disciples, man, they were just ordinary people, most of them. Everyday people, salt of the earth kind of people. And so what? God doesn't always use. So you're like, man, I'm not the sharpest. I don't know my Bible that well. I'm not a Bible scholar. I haven't studied. I haven't done this or that. Listen, God uses available people. You know what the Bible really says? That when you don't know what to say, he'll tell you what to say. What else are you, what are you waiting for? So be available for God to use me. Secondly, be alert for divine opportunities for God to use me. Be alert for divine opportunities for God to use me. You want me to tell you what? When you decide, God, I'm willing to do anything, doesn't matter where it is, doesn't matter where it leads, doesn't matter what I have to do. You want me to tell you what? You'll find God putting people in your path all the time that you can share the gospel with. I'm going to give you the name of a book. You'll have to find it. You'll get it cheap because it's not in print anymore and it's just old used copies that's out there. A book by Nellie Pickard, a lady, and it's What Do You Say When? What do you say when? And it's a great read because what you're doing is you're just reading her stories and accounts of how she shared the gospel with people. And she'd say, you know, she'd talk about, I run into this situation and this happened, and that led to an open door to me to share the gospel. If you'll just be attuned to God, if you'll be attuned to the Holy Spirit, you know, I'll tell you what, you'll have more opportunities to share the gospel just living life than if you went out on Tuesday night visitation. That's the way God wants us to do it as we are living life. And so as you live, God will put people in your path and they'll just say something. And when you're attuned to God, the Holy Spirit will be, there's your door. Walk through it and you'll get to share the gospel with people. The third thing, step to prepare to go is be prepared for God to use me. That's what today's all about. Be prepared for God to use me. That's what today's all about. You feel incapable. At Riverwoods Church, we want to equip you. We want to train you. We want to disciple you so that you can be confident in sharing your faith. So how does it begin? It begins with praying. If you'll pray for people, you'll find you're a whole lot more effective at sharing the gospel with them. And you pray for them by name. And then after you pray for them, you practice sharing the gospel. So I want to begin with praying for people. It looks like this side and this side, you're about equal. Those have been mashed down. The band has pushed those down. I hope you've got some... the vibration in here, some more people you've thought about and prayed about that need to know Christ as their Savior. And not only do they need to know Christ as their Savior, you're supposed to be inviting them to church next Sunday. If you remember that, next Sunday is the day you're supposed to try to get them to come with you. We're going to talk a little more about that. But here's what I found, that if we will be serious about it, God will use us. So I know you've got some names that you want to place on these, and we're going to do that, and we're going to pray over these names. We've seen God use this through the years. We haven't done this in over a year and a half now. So I hope, you know, some of you think back to the people, you know, I'm not saying go hang out with them and run with them, but think about the people that you have run with in the past before you got your life on track and going the right direction, and maybe they need Christ. You want me to tell you where you ought to start? You ought to start by writing their name on this card, and we're going to place them in these tubes. And so we're going to ask you to come right now. There's some pens over here, and here's some cards, and let's write some names on these cards. If I had somebody that was lost and I loved, I'd come put their name in here every week. I mean, I'd just do it. I'd say, God, I'm serious about it. I want you to use me. I want you to use me. Any of y'all know any people that's not in church or doesn't know Christ? Come on up here and put their name on the card. You say, I already put it on there. Well, it ain't going to hurt to do it again. It's usually little simple acts that God uses and blesses. It's not the big things, the grandiose things. It's the little things oftentimes that God uses. So once you put the name, just hang out up here. In just a moment, we're going to pray over these names, all right? Fold that where the name's on the inside and then drop it in that tube. Then we're going to wait right here and pray. All right, everybody done? Let's pray. Father, as we come to you today, God, we come praying for the names that have been placed in these tubes. God, we're asking for you to work in their life, for you to do what man can't do. Lord, if they don't know you, we pray they'd come to know you. God, we pray that they'd realize that they're hopeless. Help them to get at the end of the rope, the bottom of the barrel. God, get them to the place that there's nowhere to look but up. God, we agree with you that without Christ, they deserve to be separated from you for eternity in the lake of fire, which the Bible calls hell. God, we know that hell is real and heaven is real, and the thing that makes the difference is Jesus. God, I pray that as we go and invite them, they'd come with us next Sunday. God, we pray that some of them would come to know Christ as their personal Savior. Bless and get glory to yourself now. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. So how do we start? We start by praying. Oh, I just get me a journal or in the binder part of your Bible in those pages. That's how I used to do it. And I'd meet somebody that was lost, didn't know the Lord. I'd write their name down and I could bring that Bible and show it to you. And I just keep, whenever I was impressed about people, put their name on there. And then I'd use that every day to pray for people by name to come to know Christ as their Savior. And some days God would really burden me about somebody's name. And I would get to them as quick as I could to share the gospel with them. Oftentimes they would come to know Christ as their Savior. The Holy Spirit of God can prepare the heart. And so what, it begins by prayer. That doesn't mean that as you're living life and you meet people and God opens the door that you don't share the gospel with them because you haven't prayed for them. Maybe somebody else prayed for them and God's got their heart ready and he has you there to talk to them. And so what, we got to understand that most people that we get to lead to Christ, somebody else has sown some seed, somebody else has prayed and the Holy Spirit of God's watered it and you get to be there to see what, the fruit. And so what, we got to understand that God uses all of that together. But do not dismiss the power of prayer. Some people, listen to me now, some people are only going to make it to heaven when somebody else cares enough to pray them into heaven. That's how. And so what do we need to do? Be alert for divine opportunities for God to use me. Thirdly, be prepared for God to use me. I've done told you that, but I'm telling you that again. So we prayed for people today. I'm going to give you four ways to increase your confidence in sharing your faith today. All right? Four of them. First one, invite to church. Invite to church. You need to be inviting people to church. You don't have to be a theology expert to invite people to church. You don't have to know the Bible inside and out to invite people to church. You can invite them to church. Now, don't mistake inviting the church for sharing the gospel, but inviting the church is a good way for you to begin. And when they get here, oftentimes at Riverwoods Church, we're going to share the gospel. We're going to give them an opportunity. I promise you, next Sunday, when you're supposed to bring these people, you've wrote their name down to church with you next Sunday, I'm going to guarantee you they will have an opportunity to say yes or no to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just one of those things that we're going to do. So invite to church. You know people who aren't in church, don't you? You know people not in church. By the way, even right here in the heart of the Bible Belt, Marshall County, Callaway County, 70% of the people don't go to church on any given Sunday. So there's plenty of room to share the gospel. Did you know this? 79% of Americans, they've done research, wouldn't mind if a friend invited them to church. You see, we're scared to death to invite them, aren't we? We're scared to death to talk to them. But they wouldn't mind. Barna is a research company, and here's what they found, is that 50% of unchurched people, if invited, would immediately accept an invitation to attend. You know why we don't have anybody coming to church with us? Is because we're not inviting anybody. And if they tell you no, invite somebody else. And if they tell you no, invite somebody else. We're supposed to be inviting people to church. In John 1, 41 through 42, the first thing Andrew did was to find his brother, Simon, and tell him, "We have found the Messiah," that is, the Christ, "and he brought him to Jesus." Amen. Another way to talk with your friends is do versus done. Do versus done. Maybe somebody here, you're like, "I'm not really interested in that Christianity thing. Man, there's just too many rules that you have to follow. There's too much of a to-do list that has to be done." And a lot of unchurched people and undoctrinated people believe that. They think that you earn God's favor. They think you have to do stuff in order to go to heaven. Christianity is not based on what I do. Going to heaven's not based on what I do. It's not based on what I don't do. It's based on Jesus Christ. Two letters in the difference of religion and Christianity. There's lots of religions. And most of them, what they talk about, monotheistic religions talk about that you have to do something, you have to be good, you have to live good, and I'll get into that in the next point a little bit more, but you have to do in order to go to heaven. The two letters is N-E. The difference in Christianity and what the Bible teaches salvationists, man, is the difference of do and done. When it comes to our salvation, it's already been done for us at the cross of Jesus Christ. If you could get to heaven on the basis of what we do, if I could get there, if you could get there on the basis of what we do, why would Jesus have to come and die for us? You see, when it's on the basis of what you do, it has nothing to do with Jesus. It's about what you do or you don't do. But that's what most people believe that it is. Listen, I want you to know that Jesus Christ came, born of a virgin, conceived of the Holy Spirit of God, had an earthly mother, a heavenly father, and was born into this world. Here in just a couple of months, we're going to celebrate the fact that Jesus Christ has born the greatest gift that's ever been given, lived a sinless life, went to the cross at Calvary, and was crucified, buried, and rose again from the dead in order to redeem us, in order to purchase our salvation. It's not on what you do. It's on the basis of what He's done. Amen. Jesus Christ, our Savior. Listen to this. It said, God saved you by His special favor when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. Amen. Third way is the morality ladder. The morality ladder. This thing probably has light glaring on it, but maybe you can see it. A ladder. On the back of your notes, don't take up the whole area because I'm going to have you to draw something on the next point too. I get to erase mine so I can... draw you a ladder. At the top, right heaven. At the bottom, right hell. You see, that's what most of Christianity is today. They've made it morality, not spirituality. And here's what they believe. You know, the better you are, the closer you climb to heaven. You get to get there. Here's earth. Ladders propped on it. Heaven. Third heaven. We understand heaven here. Hell there. It's just something we understand. Maybe that's where they're at, but we understand that. And they think the better you are, you climb these rungs. Let me ask you something. Who's one of the best people you could think of ever in all of history? If anybody, you know, was going to go to heaven, they probably would because of what life they lived. Mother Teresa, right? She'd come to a lot of people's mind. How about this? I know you can't read it back there, but it's Billy Graham. When you think that's probably two of the best people that's ever lived. Now let me ask you a question. Who do you think is one of the worst people that's ever lived? Yeah, I knew it was coming. So we'd put Mother Teresa and Billy Graham up here and we'd put Hitler down there, right? Now I've got another question for you. Did you draw that ladder on the back page there? I want you to do that. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to, based on your morality, how good you are, put yourself on that ladder. Where would you put yourself? Huh? That's probably about where I'd put myself. Where would you put yourself? Now here's what I want you to do. Look over and look at your neighbor and put your neighbor on there. Where would you put your neighbor? Well, I don't guess then. I'll look at my wife, you know. Everybody knows that's right, right? Yeah. You get to know her, you believe it. Amen. Yeah. By the way, most people put somebody else just a little bit under them. Do you know that? Now I'm going to ask you another question. Where do you think the line on that ladder is where you have to be above to go to heaven? Okay. Most people put it right under themselves, wherever you put yourself. I'm just talking about they've studied it. Most people put it right under themselves. They do. But see, here's the whole thing about it. That's the way we as Americans view this. Here's what most Americans believe, that if I'm good enough, I get to go to heaven. Where's the line on this ladder? We had somebody who said it's right down here. Some would say, you want me to show you where God's line is on this ladder? You want me to tell you why? Because God is perfect. He is holy. God can't sin. In order to go to heaven, sin is not going to be in the presence of God. It's not going to be there. You see, here's the whole thing about the gospel of Jesus Christ is you don't have to climb the ladder in order to get to heaven. And here's why. God came to the bottom of the ladder in Jesus. When Jesus came, He came down here. God came and walked among us in the flesh of Jesus Christ. You can't climb the ladder to get to heaven. You don't have to climb a ladder to get to heaven because God came to the bottom of the ladder through Jesus Christ. So what do you have to do? You just have to know Jesus, amen? You have to know Christ as your Savior. Wow. Listen to what the Bible says. We are made right in God's sight when we trust in Jesus Christ to take away our sins. And we all can be saved in the same way, no matter who we are or what we have done. What's the Bible say in order to go to heaven? Trust Jesus Christ. Trust the one that came to the bottom of the ladder. And His name is Jesus, amen? I mean, that's it. So when you talk to people, you know, they're going to be like, man, I don't know, I can't trust Christ. Man, I've been wicked, I'm a sinner. There's some of you. There ain't no way I could go to heaven. You don't know what I've done, Pastor Darren. Can I tell you something? It doesn't matter what you've done. Doesn't matter. Well, who's the one that's going to judge what sin's worse? That's all sin, amen? We're sinners. We're born in sin. In sin did my mother conceive me and shape me in iniquity. We're sinners. We're all sinners. You say, well, Brother Darren, I killed somebody. Don't nobody know it, but I did. Listen, God will forgive you. You want me to tell you what? Listen to me now. Every one of us here today, our sin killed Jesus. The Son of God, God Himself in the flesh, the blood of Him is on our hands. Doesn't matter who you are, what you've done. And so when people talk about doing stuff, doing it's not going to get you there because it's already been done in Christ Jesus. Then that leads me to the last point, the three circles. The three circles. The first circle I want you to see is God's design. God has designed something for us. It's perfect. That was what He made. Well, what happened? We're not living in God's perfect design anymore because He created man with a free will, and man did what? Had sin. And so as a result of sin, it's led to brokenness. Brokenness shows up in lots of ways. One of the ways it shows up is in addiction, sexual immorality. Sometimes it's workaholism. Sometimes it's depression. You can name about anything that you want to that's adverse in this world, and it's a result of a deviation from God's design as a result of sin, and it's led to brokenness. Why do most marriages, or over half the marriages, and even in the church, wind up in divorce? Because of sin and brokenness. That's why. It's one of those things. But let me share another circle with you. And that's the gospel. You say, Brother Darren, really, what is the gospel? What it means is good news. Good news. You see, the thing is that Adam's sin, the result of Adam's sin, we're all sinners, and it's led to brokenness. Listen, there is a land that's fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. There is a place where there's no more sickness, no more sorrow, no more crying, no more pain, no more death, no more of that stuff. That's heaven. But we're not there yet. And there's only one way to get there, and that's the gospel. As I said in the last point, why did Jesus Christ have to come and die for us? Here's why. We can't save ourselves. The gospel is this: the birth of Jesus, the death of Jesus, the burial of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus, and also the ascension. Death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. If you leave the resurrection out, you don't have the gospel. Jesus Christ came. So you say, well then, Brother Darren, how do we move from brokenness to here? Repent. And believe. When you repent, that's if you're going in this direction and you turn around and start going in this direction, that's repentance. A change of mind, a change of heart that leads to a change of direction. A lot of people teach that repentance is if you're going here, you stop and you turn around. That's not repentance, because you're standing the same place you were. You not only have to turn around, you have to take a step in the other direction. And now you're going in the other direction. A lot of people just turned around. It ain't long they turn back around and go the way they were coming. So what? Repent and believe. What? Believe in Jesus Christ. Believe that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that if you believe in Him, you would not perish, but have everlasting life. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son is condemned, amen? And so you have to understand that. But when you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, then guess what? You get to be rescued and pursue God's original design. You have purpose in life. You have purpose in life. Recover. Pursue. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. What? For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. 1 Peter 3:15. You must worship Christ as Lord of your life, and if someone asks about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it. We're going to do a more in-depth evangelism teaching before too long. I hope that you'll come to it. Because here's why. God calls all of us to share our faith. That's not just the preacher's job. That's not just the staff's job. All of us are to share our faith. And so what do we need to do? We need to pray, and we need to prepare, and then we need to practice. Practice. You're going to get a chance this week to practice. Invite somebody to church. Talk to somebody about Christ. Ask them if they know for certain they have eternal life and they go to heaven if they were to die. Ask them if you stood before the Lord right now and He asked you, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say to Him? What would you say to Him? If you're like, well, I'm trying to live good, that's not going to work. Oh, I go to church. Going to church is important, but that's not going to get you to heaven. The only thing that's going to get you to heaven is if you know Christ as your personal Savior. That's it. Not how much you do, not how much you've done. And by the way, doing is not going to keep you saved either. Jesus didn't die 100 times at the cross at Calvary. He died once. Once and for all. And if you come to know Him, it is a birth. It's a spiritual birth. Birth is a one-time experience. If my mother could have unborn me, I'm quite sure she would have a few times in my life. But birth is a one-time experience. And what He told Nicodemus, marvel not that I say unto you that you must be born again. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit, and it is a spiritual birth, and it can't be undone. Have you had that spiritual birth? Have you had that spiritual birth? If not, you need to. If not, you need to. In just a moment, we're going to sing as they make their way up here, and there'll be somebody here to receive you. You say, Brother Darren, are you going to lead us in a prayer to receive Christ today? No, I'm not. I'm going to let you do that. I'm going to let you do that. What are you trusting? Where are you at on the ladder? What are you trusting to get you to heaven? Let me tell you what you better do. You better run into the arms of Jesus, because He's the only thing that makes a difference. Let's stand. Let's sing. You come as we sing.
I stumble.